While they were there, it was time for a baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in cloth and put him in a manger because there was no guest room available open for them.
And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over the flocks at night.
And angels of the Lord appeared to them.
And the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified.
But the angels said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people.
Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord.
This shall be a sign unto you, a baby wrapped in cloth and lying in a manger."
Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying,
Glory to God in the highest heaven, peace on earth, peace to those in his favor rests.
Would you join me as we pray together? Gracious God and Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight that we can gather in your name. We thank you that you have entered history in the person of Jesus, that on that first Christmas, God, we can celebrate the advent of your Son, that miraculous birth. Lord, we come tonight to focus on what you have done for us and to give gratitude for who you are and how you have acted in history. May all that we do in this place be pleasing in your sight and bring glory to your name. And I pray in Christ's name, amen.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas.
Why don't we sing some Christmas songs together? Why don't you all stand?
Joy for all ye nations, rise!
Well, I have to confess, it's not really feeling much like Christmas to me this year. I think reason number one is it's hot as that other place outside right now, which we don't talk about in church. Well, we sort of do, but not usually. No. It's just doesn't feel that Christmassy. Another reason for us, we were talking about the other night, especially as I see the little ones up here, our little ones aren't so little anymore. They're a lot bigger. You know, the youngest is 20 now, so the magic, the thrill, all that sort of stuff is not the same as when you have the little ones. But really, when I boil it down, here's the thing for me, and maybe for you too, that's working against Christmas for me, and that's just I'm too doggone busy. There's too much going on. I've been amazed. Even the last couple of days, I have observed things that have somewhere between shocked and appalled me as I've been out. We did this thing up at Kmart. We've done it for the last several years where we wrap gifts for free. So thank you to all those who came out and helped us wrap gifts for these last few days. And hey, just curious, any of you here because you met us at Kmart and we wrapped a gift? Oh, look at that. We got some gift wrap people. Awesome. If you liked it, my name is Charles. If you didn't, well, my name's not Charles. No, I had nothing to do with it. Yeah, if you liked it, this is First Baptist. If you didn't, this is Burton Methodist. No, I'm just kidding. There we go. So, you know, you're just busy, and I saw it. I mean, you're watching the traffic. Have you seen the craziness? Have you been on the highway today? Somebody was saying earlier, they were driving north, and, you know, you kind of just a lot of people from out of town here, and they don't know, and they're looking for things, and they're going slow, and the locals or maybe those in a hurry are zipping out around. I know nobody that would come to church on Christmas Eve did this, so I'm sure I'm talking to the right people. And of course, you know, trying to be kind of polite and patient, waiting your turn there while the person makes the turn. Somebody zips out around them and crash. Big happy fun. That'll ruin a Christmas, huh? Hey, if you don't believe in the sinful nature of humanity, then go to Publix on Christmas Eve and it will be in huge display. I mean, whoa. You know, when the cashier lines are backed up, and if you've been there, there's just that little area to get by, and you've got the people coming out of the aisles, turning, and the people that are trying to go the one way, and the people trying to go the other way, and the one guy that apparently is the most important person in the store that just blows by everybody, because, you know, you try to be polite. I'm going to move to the side and let somebody go, and then 47 people go right by you. You're like, really? It is amazing to me. And I understand what everybody's doing. I understand why there's that sense of hurry, because we have so much to do. And we're looking forward to celebrating. But I think it's easy, at least in my experience, to get so caught up in the things I have to do that I can miss the celebration. I could miss Christmas. So you'd be commended tonight for coming out and making time to be here. Because I hope tonight you don't miss Christmas. I think as the kids read that Luke chapter 2 story, one of the things in that passage about Christmas that jumps out to me is the place where it says that Jesus was born in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And it's a staple of Christmas pageants and Christmas plays. You got to have, he's kind of like the villain of Christmas in some ways, the innkeeper, right? Somebody has to play that person who, when Mary and Joseph come up, and Mary, obviously pregnant, obviously traveled a long way, needing a room, and the innkeeper, at least in most of the plays I remember, doesn't get a speaking part, he just kind of gets this part. You know, no room here, keep going. And I understand a little bit of the plight of that innkeeper because, let's be honest, Mary and Joseph were going to be some high-maintenance customers. Is that fair to say? I mean, they had a lot going on. And if you have a, you know, in that day, the inn wasn't some high-rise, newly constructed individual bed and bath or suites. It was your house that you opened up because all of these people had to go to the place that Caesar told them to be taxed. And if you had a little extra room, a little extra place on your floor, you could get a few extra dollars by having people stay there. And if you're already pretty full, I'm not thinking when somebody comes knocking on your door, you're thinking, this would make my Christmas complete. Not only do I get to pay taxes, but she's going to have a baby right here in my living room. Woohoo! So, you know, maybe not the worst of motives, but certainly in the pressure of the moment, it was easy to miss that right in front of not just the one innkeeper that shows up, but probably several places that they sought shelter, that all of them just didn't make room, didn't have the time, because the demands that were on them were just too much. There's a scripture that comes to mind from the Old Testament. It's in Psalm chapter 46, verse 10. It says this, "Be still and know that I am God." And I wonder sometimes when I think about the lives that we lead and the pace at which we lead them, if one of the greatest schemes to keep us away from God that the enemy ever came up with was just never letting us find time to be still. Never letting us find that moment where there wasn't something pressing, there wasn't another meeting, there wasn't another assignment, there wasn't another task that had to be done, and we could put that aside for a minute and just focus. Just be still and know that He is God. So it's my hope tonight that somewhere, maybe in the familiarity of the carols that we'll sing together, or maybe because of just the warm glow of candlelight, or maybe it's the company of family and friends that you're here with tonight, that somewhere in this hour or so we'll spend together, that you'll be able to be still. Still enough so that you would know He, the Christ child born in Bethlehem, He is God.
Love incarnate, love divine, star and angels gave the sign. Bow to babe on bended knee, the savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, He shall reign forevermore. No.
All right, now let's listen. I want you to look at the candy cane while we're reading it, because this is a fun story about the candy cane. You probably love to eat them every year, but did you know that there's actually... You didn't get one, buddy?
Yeah, my brother did. Here, I'll pass it.
Thank you so very much. Shh. Okay, here we go. On a dreary evening in the depths of November, a stranger rode into town. He stopped his horse in front of a lonely storefront. The windows were boarded shut, and the door was locked fast, but the man looked at it and smiled and said, "It will do." All through the gray, short days and the long, dark nights of November, the man worked. The townspeople could hear the faint pam, pam, pam of his hammer and the snish, snish, snish of his saw. They could smell the sweet, clean scent of new lumber and the deep, oily smell of new paint. But no one knew who the man was or what he was doing. The mayor hoped he was a doctor to heal his illness. The young wives hoped he was a tailor to make beautiful dresses. The farmers hoped he was a trader to exchange their grains for good. But the children, they had the strongest, deepest wish of all, a wish they did not tell their parents, a deep, quiet, secret wish that none of them said out loud. No one spoke to the man. No one asked if he needed help. They just waited and watched and wondered and wished. But one small girl watched and wondered and waited and wished longer than she could stand. Okay. And one snowy day, she knocked at the stranger's door. "Hello," she said. "My name is Lucy. Do you need some help?" The man smiled warmly and nodded, and then he opened the door, and Lucy stepped inside. A long counter ran down the side of the room. Bare shelves filled the opposite walls. In the backs were dozens and dozens of barrels and crates. "Could you help me unpack?" the man asked. Lucy's heart sank at the sight of the boxes. Oh, what if there were only barrels of nails and bags of flour? But she removed her dripping boots and hung her coat on a peg. On stocking feet, she crossed the rough wooden floor and knelt beside a crate. "Please, open it," the man urged. Slowly, Lucy put her hand into the box and pulled out an object wrapped in tissue. Round and heavy, it almost slipped through her fingers. Lucy trembled a little as she unwrapped it. It was a glass jar. Lucy gave the man a puzzled look. "Go on," his nod said. Shashuan packed another glass jar and another until she was completely surrounded by jars of all shapes and sizes, tall and thin and round and squat, jars with lids and jars without. "Now," the man said, "for something to put inside." And as he pulled over a huge crate stamped with a strange word, it says confections. As Lucy unpacked, her eyes lit up. It was candy, her favorite candy, gumdrops. "Try some," the man said. She popped one in her mouth. Now she could hardly unwrap fast enough. Peppermint sticks and taffy and lollipops and chewing gum. Wide-eyed, she looked at the man. "We wished," Lucy said. "Yes, I know," said the man. "And here it is. Welcome to Sonman's Candy Store. I am John Sonman." Soon the small store was filled with candies gleaming in their glass jars, raspberry suckers and tiny lemon drops, brightly colored jawbreakers and long tangles of licorice, pink and white peppermints for church and butterscotch balls for company. Then in the very last package, in the very last crate, was a candy Lucy had never seen before. Everybody look at your candy. A red and white striped candy stick with a crook on the end. "What is this?" Lucy asked. "This," Mr. Sonman explained, "is a candy cane. It is a very special Christmas candy." "Why?" Lucy asked. "Tell me," Mr. Sonman said, "what letter does it look like?" Lucy took the candy and turned it in her hand. "J," she said. "Yes," Mr. Sonman smiled, "J for Jesus, who was born on Christmas Day." "Now, turn it over. What does it remind you of?" Lucy turned the candy in her hand. She peered down intently. "Oh, I know," she said finally. "It's a shepherd's staff. Who were the first to find out about Jesus' birth?" Who were the first to find out about Jesus' birth? Mr. Solomon asked. Shepherds in the field, Lucy answered, watching over their flocks by night. But, Mr. Solomon, what are the stripes for? Lucy asked. The man's eyes grew sad. The prophet Isaiah said, by his stripes we are healed. Before he died on the cross, Jesus was whipped. He bled terribly. The red reminds us of his suffering and his blood. But then, Mr. Solomon continued, the candy is white as well. When we give our lives to Jesus, his blood washes away all our sins, making us white and pure as snow. That, he said, is the story of the candy cane. Is it a secret? Lucy asked. Mr. Solomon looked at her for a long moment. It's a story that needs to be told, he said. Will you help me share it? It was now the depths of December. The town was whipped round by blizzard's winds. For days, the sun hid itself. But every morning, Mr. Solomon and Lucy ventured out. They wore heavy woolen coats and brightly hand-knit scarves. And in their stiff, mittened fingers, they each held a bag. They went to every house in town. They traveled to every farm in the country. They knocked on every door and on every home. They told the story. They left a small gift, and they gave an invitation. On the afternoon of Christmas Eve, the sun finally broke through the clouds and Solomon's candy store officially opened. The mayor came, feeling better than he'd felt in days. The young wives came, dressed in beautiful smiles. The farmers came, eager to trade grain for Christmas gifts. The children ran in dizzy circles. Yes, their wish had come true. Yes, they had come to share in the opening of the candy store. But they shared something more, something bigger, something better. Candy, but Jesus is even better. On that Christmas Eve, they shared the story of the candy cane. They told of the miracle of Christ's birth and the misery of his death and the mercy of his love. Okay, it's all right. Yes, you may.
Someone took my other piece, then I can eat a piece.
Okay. Did you guys like the story? Carefully walk back to your parents, okay?
Okay. Please stand up and sing some more Christmas carols.
Thank you.
For Christmas. For a lot of people, it is the highlight of their year. Maybe you're one of those folks that's here tonight. You look forward to it. You do so much to get ready for it, and it's here. It seems like a long time. It seems looking back when I was a kid that it took a lot longer to get here than it does now. Maybe you feel the same way. It's only 365 days between those events, that holiday. And yet we sing a song like that, and it brings to mind the fact that as Israel waited between the testaments, between the Old Testament and the beginning of the New Testament, between that moment when they felt God's speaking to them and they suffered under oppression and desired God to answer on their behalf, not just 365 days, not even 5 years or 10 years, but about 400 years of waiting and longing. We get to the New Testament, and the gospel writers tell the story of Jesus, and they all tell it a little differently. Probably my favorite is the Gospel of John. It's not the traditional one. It's not the one that we often think of. He's rather philosophical in the way he puts his story of the coming of Christ into the world. And he echoes back to the very first pages of the Bible when Genesis 1:1 tells us that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And John brings that to mind when he begins his book, "In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. And without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life. And that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." That light that was Jesus shone into the darkness of that 400 years where they felt God's silence. And he uses that not just for the connection in Israel's history, but I think also to that idea of light. They say, and we'll find out in a little bit, everybody looks better by candlelight. Maybe that's why this is my favorite service of the year. But nonetheless, you know, that's what they say. We're all going to have our candles in just a little bit. And the light will sweep across this room. But light is interesting. Light, have you noticed it always wins? Light and darkness, we say, are opposites. But one thing that we also know is they're not equals. Because whenever the light shines, the darkness is dispelled. I've told this story before. Maybe you have something like this in your house. In our bedroom, we have a little device that connects to our TV, allows us, you know, that kind of that TV all over the house sort of thing. And on that device is a tiny little green light. I mean, it is small. It is tiny. But at 3 a.m., dang, it is horrible. It's like, you know, somebody's got a spotlight shining in my face. Wake up, Charles. There's chickens to feed. I don't know what it's saying. That's what I hear. It's just right in my, it just drives me crazy. And so throw a towel over it, but inevitably the towel falls back. I mean, it's just that little light. Now, how many of you here sleep with a nightlight? I'm talking to the adults, not the kids. Right? Because you have kids and you're doing it for them. Right? But that nightlight, we have sometimes some little ones spend the night and we put a nightlight in the area of the bathroom so they can see. I don't like that either. Just a little bit of light doesn't take much, just a watt or two. And it seems like it's daylight. And that's the picture that John 1 begins to paint, that the light has shined in the darkness, but it says in verse 5, and the darkness does not overcome it, because though light and dark are opposites, they're definitely not equals. But then a few verses later, he says something that really jumps out at me. He says about Jesus in verse 9, let me turn back to my bulletin where that is, and he says, "The true light that gives light to everyone is coming into the world." And it never occurred to me till I was reading some things, but that phrase, true light, this year jumped out at me. What does it mean, true light? Because, you know, true light, does that imply that there's false light? What is false light? What does it mean, false light? And I thought a lot about that. And here's what I came up with, and got some help from some other folks as they thought about it. But here's what I came up with. False light is darkness that doesn't seem so dark anymore. Years ago, we took some of the teens from our church up to North Carolina, and one of the adventures we had is we went caving. And if you've ever been caving, or if you want to feel, special, we went spelunking. I don't know what that means. It's just fun to say. But that's what we did. So we went in the cave, and you put on the little headlamps, and the hole that we went into, I had to crawl in. It wasn't like a big gaping cave. It was a tiny little cave, kind of slid down this area, went in there, and got into the cave. And at some point when we're in there, the guide was telling us, look, I want you to see how dark it is in here. Turn off your headlamp. And so everybody, the group of 8 or 10 of us, turned off our headlamp. That was a little shocking. That was a lot shocking. Because when you're in a cave and you've kind of crawled back into it for a while, there is no light getting in there. And the guide told us, put your hand in front of your face. And you put your hand in front of your face. You can't see. Isn't that a phrase, right? You can't see your hand in front of your face. He said, leave it there. And we did. He said, now in a few minutes, you're going to notice the outline of your hand showing up. He said, that's not really your hand. It's your mind that tells you your hand is in front of it and begins to draw the outline of your hand. Your mind begins to trick you that you can actually see your hand. It's impossible to see your hand because there's no light in this cave. We're too far in and none of it's getting in here. And I thought, ooh, I hope my headlamp comes back on. There's 10 of us in here. At least a couple of them got to work, right? Anybody been to, Ruby Falls? When you get in there, they turn off the light. Don't you hate that part? Hey, the next time you go in, look at the wiring on the wall and see if that doesn't make you uncomfortable. That's what gets you in the elevator, and that's what keeps it light in there. I'm just saying, you'll never look at it the same way again. You know, but back to the point, what is false light? It's darkness that doesn't seem so dark anymore. Jesus came into this world, and this writer John says the true light came in. I think he said that on purpose because he was speaking to people who were following some false light. So he was speaking to the Jewish nation that had this history of religion, that had the commandments from Mount Sinai, that had the sacrificial system, that had this very elaborate way with the temple as its centerpiece to go about their religious life. And what happens at times, not just for them, but for you and I as well, in the practice of religion, is we substitute false light for true light. We substitute the ritual, we substitute the routine for that which is the real, which is what we're here to celebrate tonight, the gift of Jesus, the true light that came into the world, God that became flesh, the one that invites us to know him. This is eternal life, he said, that you may know me, or you may know the only true God and his son, me whom you have sent. Jesus tells us eternal life or salvation or however you want to term it in that sense isn't about this series of rituals that we go through. And sometimes in our life we begin to substitute some things. We think if we do some things that somehow God might like us better. For instance, some people come to church because they think God likes them better when they're in this room than when they leave and go to another room. I don't know if it's good news or bad news for you. He don't love you any more or less depending on what seat you sit in. Because you know what? He sees who you really are. And I can come to church, and I know I'm the preacher, I can come to church, and God is not happy with what's going on in here. There's all sorts of stuff. You didn't have to amen that so heartily. I don't know. No. But you know what I'm saying. You got that stuff that's in there, and your attitude is not right, and the things that are on your mind and are just not right. And I'm at church, and I'm standing up on stage, and I'm talking to all these people. It must be okay. And I can substitute that for what's real. You can substitute the religious ritual. Some people substitute other things. They substitute things that give them security, things that give them a sense of, okay, I'm stable, I'm safe, I'm secure. Maybe it's position or it's power or it's wealth, things that we try to amass to somehow make us feel like these are signs that God is more pleased with us than otherwise. And the nation of Israel was just like that. They lived their life trying to find the things, trying to find the key somehow that unlocked the blessing of God. And into that environment and into your life and into this environment comes this message that John said, the true light has come into the world. That it's no longer about doing the right rituals. It's no longer about going to the right places at the right times for the services. No, it's not about those things that too often we substitute for it. The true light shows us, and the real message of Christmas is that we can know God personally through his Son, Jesus Christ. That which ultimately separated us from God wasn't just our lack of religious habits, but it was that thing inside of us that's inside of me and you and everybody else that's called that sinful nature that manifests itself from time to time, like earlier today I mentioned at Publix. And we don't really mean to do it, and we don't really want to do it, but we end up doing it anyway. And we think, okay, now I've got to balance that out somehow. Got to do some good over here. And the message of Christmas is the true light is you can't balance that out. God doesn't expect you to balance that out because, well, you can't. What he expects you to do is just ask him to forgive you. Remember what the kids quoted in Luke 2 earlier? And this message that the angels brought was that there is a Savior that has been born to you. And his name is Christ the Lord. A Savior. Why did the angel tell the shepherds there was a Savior? Because they needed salvation. They didn't need a religious system. They had one of those. They didn't need better commandments. They had plenty, and they were the best you could find. God himself wrote them on a tablet. They didn't need self-help or any of that sort of thing. They didn't need even an example to follow, though Jesus offered them that. They needed someone to save them from their sins. And that's exactly what God gave when he gave Jesus. You know, I think sometimes for me, the temptation, the thing that blocks the view of God, the view of Christmas, the view of Christ, that busyness I talked about earlier, because of the nature of my work, I guess, it's probably church stuff. If you've been in church world much at all in your life, if you're in church world right now, if you work at a church or volunteer at a church or serve at a church, you know church will take over your life. There's always something to do. And it's easy to think, well, I'm doing something, I must be okay. Psalm 46:10 says, be still. Not do more, but be still. And know that I am God. Maybe that's why this moment that we use to close the service is so meaningful. Because we are a little bit still. And we focus on something that's important. And I'm going to get us started if that's okay. I usually do. You know, we have the Advent wreath here. No, it's probably weird to see an Advent wreath in a Baptist church if you're surprised, but we have one. And the center candle is called the Christ candle. We only light it Christmas Eve. The picture of the candle is the light, the true light that came into the world. The light that was Jesus Christ. Not to give us more to do, but to save us from ourselves. And he came and he lived those 33 or so years. And he taught and he worked miracles. And eventually he was arrested and tried and crucified, laid in a tomb. And a few days later, the writers of the Bible record that he rose again. And he ascended to the right hand of the Father. And he's seated there now. And Scripture tells us that Jesus, born so commonly, so simply in a manger, is the Savior, is the true light of the world. So tonight, symbolically, we pass this light from candle to candle. And I say symbolically because the privilege we have isn't just to sit in a service like this and light candles together and watch the glow spread across the room. But the real privilege comes when we take the message of the true light, Jesus himself, and spread that one person to another. In the midst of our busyness, in the midst of the tasks that are always seeming to demand our time and attention, Jesus would invite us, and God would call us to be still and to know that he is God. You know, I have a unique perspective on this part of the service. I get to watch how you guys act, share in the light. And there's always a few that get up, can't wait to pass the light around. I don't know, maybe they just want to go. 7:03, been here an hour. Got something in the oven, maybe. Or maybe it's because they really want to make sure that everybody gets a chance to hold a candle. Maybe that's the challenge to us. That we don't just get to pass the light of a candle along, but we can tell others about the true light that came into this world. The light that shines in darkness and the darkness does not overcome it. The light whose name is Jesus. The baby born in a manger who died on the cross and rose so that whosoever calls upon the name of Jesus will be saved. Because that was the message of the angels after all. Tonight in the city of David, a Savior has been born to you. And he is Christ the Lord. We're going to close our service as we usually do. And I'm sure we're not the only service that does it this way. But we're going to close by singing Silent Night together. So I'm going to invite you to sing along. If you want to stand, you can. If you want to stay seated, you can. Whatever you would prefer. But let's sing this song, this carol, as we finish up tonight. My prayer is that the Christ child born, the birth to whose we celebrate at Christmas, that his light will penetrate your life, that his love will be for you that source of strength and hope, even in the difficulties of life. And that that salvation that he offers, you will come to know, because he offers not just religion, but he offers himself for you. Thank you for joining us tonight to celebrate Christmas Eve with us. And by the way, everybody does look better by candlelight. It's true. It's true. I hope you have a very Merry Christmas. Just a reminder, we are not having services tomorrow, Christmas Sunday. We hope you'll enjoy that time with your families, though we've made that decision. So God bless you all. Thank you for coming. And once again, have a very Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.